Channel open. Welcome back to Weekly Trek, a proud member of the Tricorder Transmissions podcast network. I am your host, Alex Perry.
What's today's date? The date.
Today's show was recorded on June 6, 2019, and is current through the end of Star Trek Discovery Season 2, so beware of spoilers. All right, let's get into the show.
Good day, Voyager, and welcome to A Briefing with Neelix. It's a catchy title, isn't it?
Weekly Trek is a 30-minute news show, or maybe a little less this week, covering the biggest stories from the Star Trek franchise. We are in a new golden age of Star Trek. There are 5 television shows in production, possibly more on the way, and enough merchandise to fill the Bajoran wormhole. So stick with me, and I will help you sort a lot of the real facts from the Dominion propaganda that you'll find online. But I can't do this alone. Or maybe I can. And my guest this week is Alex Perry. That's right. It is a pretty quiet week on the Star Trek news front. I did have a guest book for this week, Mr. Carl Wonders, but given that there was not a ton of Star Trek news, I decided to reschedule Carl at a time when we could talk about much more interesting things. So this week, I'm trying something new. I knew this day would come. I knew we would get a slow news week. It's finally happened. It took me, I think I've done maybe nearly 20 episodes in which we've had full packed weeks full of Star Trek news. But we finally had, now we're getting into the summer doldrums, a week where we didn't have all that much going on. So I'm going to try something new. Rather than have a guest, rather than do what we're feeling good about Star Trek, rather than doing the theories, this week I'm just going to give you a quick 10-minute hit on all the news you need to know from this week. And if this works out well, we will do this again for other potential slow news weeks in the future. But there are 5 shows, as I say, coming, so these weeks are likely to be more rare than not. So we'll bypass our usual order of play and get right into the week's top stories.
There's a war going on, and I'm a reporter.
So our first story this week is we finally have a cover for the next Star Trek Discovery novel, The Enterprise War by John Jackson Miller, which will be coming out on July 30th, so not that far away. The next book in the Star Trek Discovery line is actually focusing on the USS Enterprise and filling in the story of what happened to the Enterprise during Season 1 of Star Trek Discovery. So it was established in Season 1 that the Enterprise did not participate in the Klingon War, that they were too far away from the Federation, and that Starfleet did not recall them. And so this book is going to tell us the story of what happened to the Enterprise during that year, why perhaps did they not come back to the Federation, and also give us an opportunity to spend more time with characters like Captain Pike, Number One, Mr. Spock, all of whom are fan favorites as a result of Star Trek Discovery Season 2. So I'm really looking forward to this. I have to say, the cover is a bit boring. It's basically just a picture of the Enterprise taken from above, same kind of schematic picture you will find in the Eagle Moss magazines or in a lot of places, and the title. Not necessarily as interesting and dynamic as some of the other covers have been recently, but covers mean nothing in terms of the quality of the story, and John Jackson Miller is a really great Star Trek novelist. If you have read some of his previous work, like the Prey trilogy, you'll know he's a really good Star Trek author, so I'm actually really looking forward to this book. So there is a cover now. If you go on Amazon, search Star Trek Discovery, The Enterprise War, you will find that. Our next story of the week will be a shock to anybody in the cosplay world. Anovos, the company that has been making licensed high-quality Star Trek costumes for the last, I think, 4 or 5 years, is being sued. A man named Richard Dalton has sued Anovos for more than $40,000 worth of merchandise he hasn't received in a complaint he filed with the California Federal Court on Monday. He is basically alleging that he has paid all this money but has not received any of his merchandise, which, if anybody listening is a customer of Anovos, will know is pretty typical. They do run on a pre-order model where you pay and then they commit to ship to you when the product is ready. And those wait times can be pretty lengthy. I have a lot of conflicted feelings about this. I am a big fan of Anovos's work. The quality of the costumes that they put out is amazing. You will not find a better Star Trek costume on the market, I promise you that. And the depth of the number of different kinds of costumes that they have done is really tremendous. I mean, I now have a closet full of this stuff, and I think I have myself probably about 4 or 5 costumes on pre-order from them, some of which I have been waiting for a really long time. But this is a company that has not done well with transparency. They place these products up for pre-order and they say that it's expected to ship by a certain date, and they never, ever, ever meet the date that they initially set down. So there's a lot of frustration from the customer community who pay for these products thinking that they're going to get it in a certain time frame, and the company is unable to meet that time frame. And it's gotten really bad. I mean, I'm a very patient person. I'm happy to wait for the product. I know they will eventually ship it. I know once it arrives, it will be fabulous. But you can't fault people for being annoyed that what the company tells them doesn't end up being true. And they will reassign the shipping deadline again and again and again and just keep pushing it back every few months until they do eventually ship it. But 2 years might have passed in the interim. So, as I say, I'm a big fan of the work. I really hope that this does not ultimately impact the company's operations. They have a lot of good people who work there, but the company needs to do a much better job of being transparent with its customers about what to expect when they pay for these items. And it seemed like about a month ago, they were kind of recognizing that. They sent around a series of emails promising more transparency, promising they would be more honest about what was going on with their products. And since those sort of 3 blog posts, we've heard nothing. We've had no individual updates for the products that were supposed to ship by the end of last month that didn't, and we're still waiting. So I think there's been a lot of frustration from the customers, and these are very expensive products. And so I think the least that Anovos owes its customers is absolute transparency about what's going on with the products that folks have ordered. Switching from Anovos to Star Trek Discovery, as we've talked about in previous weeks, CBS has been making an Emmy push for Star Trek Discovery. We have this new exhibit that's open in the Paley Center, I think through at least the middle of this month. So if you're in LA, I encourage you to get down there and see the season 2 exhibit as quickly as possible. I've seen pictures, it's amazing. They've held a number of panels there for Emmy voters and for the public to convince them that Star Trek Discovery is a good candidate for an Emmy. And now we have word that CBS has started sending out its screener packets to Emmy voters, and they've included a CBS All Access packet, and within that there is a DVD of Star Trek Discovery episodes. It's interesting, the episodes that they've chosen. They chose the episodes Brother, The Sound of Thunder, Project Daedalus, and Perpetual Infinity. And I know what you might be saying, but Alex, those aren't the best episodes of the season. Well, I think what's really interesting about this is it kind of does tell us which categories CBS thinks they have a good chance for Discovery to win an Emmy in. New Eden and If Memory Serves are, in my opinion, the best episodes of the season, but they don't necessarily show off in the best way that the season has to offer the kinds of things that I think CBS is hoping Star Trek Discovery might be considered for an Emmy for. It's very unlikely they would get a nomination for Best Series, just because the Emmys don't love science fiction, and there are lots of other great shows that, frankly, get a lot more attention. And so instead, it looks like they're focused more on some of the technical categories, like makeup, which we have an Emmy Award-deserving makeup team for Star Trek Discovery. The production design, again, Emmy Award-deserving production design. Visual effects, I mean, you can't watch those last 2 episodes and not think that the visual effects are stupendously phenomenal in Star Trek Discovery, and the costume design. And I think those are a really good selection of episodes to show off the best of Star Trek Discovery, and hopefully it will lead to some success in the Emmys come the fall. We're not quite done with the Deep Space Nine documentary. Congratulations, fans in Australia and New Zealand. You too have got yourself a cinematic screening of the Deep Space Nine documentary, joining the US, Canada, The UK, Ireland, and Germany, Australia, and New Zealand will now have cinematic showings of the Deep Space Nine documentary. Those will take place on Saturday, June the 29th, at various cinemas across both Australia and New Zealand. Head to deepspacefathom.com to find information about which cinemas are showing the Deep Space Nine documentary. I hope you will make the trip. And our last story this week is a sad one. This week, artist Keith Birdsong passed away. If you have ever laid eyes upon a Star Trek novel from the 1990s, you have almost certainly seen Keith's work. He is a painter who has done a ton of Star Trek art, many of which have shown up in covers for novels, particularly in the 1990s. So I'm thinking about novels like Dark Mirror, Imzadi. He's done a bunch of original series novel covers, a bunch of Next Generation novel covers. He's also done, if you go to conventions, you'll find these, a lot of people will get signed these sort of paintings of the crew. That was Keith Birdsong's work. He was a tremendous, tremendous artist, and this is a huge loss for the Star Trek community. He passed away June 4th. He was 59 years old, and we wish his family the best and send our best wishes. And thanks to Keith for all of the great work he's done over the years and the fabulous art that lives on beyond him that we have to enjoy. Well, that's all the time we've got on this episode of Weekly Trek. Thank you so much to my guest, me, for joining me today. You can find the show on Twitter at Weekly Trek and me at Alexander T. Perry. And if you enjoy the show, please consider leaving us a 5-star review on your podcast player of choice. And please check out some of the other great shows on the Tricorder Transmissions. And if you like our shows, please also consider becoming a Patreon of Tricorder, which you can find at patreon.com/thetricordertransmissions. And lastly, if you're looking for Star Trek news on the internet, I hope you will turn to trekcore.com. Well, hopefully we'll have a little more news for next week. CBS, get on that. But until next week, live long and prosper.